Hey guys, welcome to another video where we are going to talk to Shambhu, who's an NLP enthusiast. He loves teaching and coaching anybody who's interested in data science. Also, he is a Kaggle notebooks and a discussion expert. In today's video, we're going to be discussing about how he has written notebooks, what are some of the tips and tricks around writing notebooks or doing discussions, and then moving up the ladder or progressing in the Kaggle environment. And last but not least, we will also be looking at a NLP code which he'll be walking us through and learning from all the possibilities that we have while writing such kind of code. So welcome, Shambhu.
Hey, hi Kunal, thanks for having me.
Shambhu, so you are a kernel expert and you're also a discussion expert. So how did you get started in terms of writing Kaggle codes, and how did you participate in discussions? First, let's begin with codes.
First, I'll say that I joined Kaggle 2 years ago when I started my data science journey. But then Kaggle was a bit intimidating for me as a data science beginner. So I didn't work on Kaggle at that time. But last year in December, I looked back at Kaggle and saw that Kaggle provides a great community to interact and learn codes. So I started writing codes, and initially my notebooks were not getting upvotes and I didn't understand why. Then I went through a number of notebooks written by grandmasters and masters. So I understood that you have to basically create a notebook as a resource. You have to provide links to learn from. You have to write what you are trying to do. So basically, you see, a Kaggle notebook is much more than some codes. A Kaggle notebook is basically what the best a data scientist can do. It's storytelling. You have to take a data set or multiple data sets, and you have to tell a story via that data set. You have to give a context, and then you have to explore the data. You have to see different types of nice visualizations. So basically it's, and then I started to see. So basically, if you want to write notebooks in Kaggle, my advice will be to read a lot of notebooks. That's what helped me to write better and better notebooks. And still today, I follow a lot of people. I follow their writing approaches, and that's what helps me to write notebooks.
Absolutely, Shambhu. So what are some of those people that have inspired you early on and still you follow them?
Yeah, so I follow Abhishek Thakur from Kaggle. You know, he is the first grandmaster. He's the first quadruple grandmaster. And then for good notebooks, I'll mention Marila Prata. She is a very veteran Kaggle. She writes a lot of notebooks and she creates awesome notebooks. And then there is Parul Pandey from H2OAI. Her notebooks are also really great. I think you can check her notebooks on Kaggle MLDS survey. They are really awesome notebooks with a lot of visualizations and storytelling, all those things. Other than that, in Kaggle, I really love the community of young people who are from colleges, who are still learning, and they are 18 years, 20 years old. I guess you know Vyom Bhatia.
Yes, yes.
I have a very good friendship with Vyom. And there is also Ayush from Kolkata. Yes. He's a great in visualization. Mm-hmm. He has some really nice notebooks. So yeah, I'll suggest anyone who is beginning to follow these guys and learn from them.
Nice. Thanks for the nice resources, Shambhu. So discussion is another ball game altogether, right? It's very difficult to get likes or upvotes on discussion. So in discussions, how do you participate and how to properly involve with the community through discussion?
So discussion is basically You see, discussion in Kaggle has started later on than notebooks. But so in discussion, you have to create value. So a lot of times what beginners do a mistake is that they'll go and just write that great work or nice post, something like that. But that doesn't create value. So to get a meaningful discussion, you have to look through all the, so let's say you are going to comment on a notebook. So go through the notebook, see what are the things they could have done better or what are the things you learned. So let's say like I go through a new Transformer notebook and I learned that, okay, there is some new code patch I learned. So you can write that. So that will help both the writer to understand what are the things people are liking, as well as anyone who is seeing your comment will notice that point.
Absolutely. So can you show us some one comment which, you know, got some good positioning and all that thing through some of your participations?
So I have, yeah, I'll show you. So, for example, look at this comment I made. So basically, this is build interactive data application using Streamlit. So as you know, or the people who do not know, I'll introduce Streamlit. So Streamlit is a data application writing software. So it's also a website, as well as you can import Streamlit as a Python library. So before Streamlit, what people had to do to deploy their apps is that, like, you have to know Django or Flask or some web framework. But now using Streamlit, you can write your data applications within hours. So I am a very like spoken person about Streamlit. So I wrote a few articles on Streamlit and I created this topic. Where you can see I introduced Streamlit and then I have provided these resources to read about.
And this is in the getting started section, right? Okay. So can you please go to the getting started section there? Yeah. So basically this is a forum like place where you can create a topic and then write something about it and people can comment or do anything within that particular place, right?
Yes.
Awesome. And so yeah, not many people know this, but you know, it's not only like you have to go and comment on the particular kernel, but you can go to these communities. It's a forum like structure, create a new forum, micro blogs sort of a structure, and then leave it there for people to learn from and comment and add or create to that particular topic, right?
Yes, exactly. And for understanding how to write new topics or anything, again, you can follow what big like the grandmasters or so there are number of Kaggle topics written by the Kaggle employees also who started some of these forums. So you can go and check their topics, how they are writing. So all those things can help you learn from.
Yeah, absolutely. So thanks for sharing this idea, Shambhu. So now going to the main part of this particular session. So can you walk us through one of the NLP kernels that you worked with and how were you thinking to solve that particular problem, right? So that's one thing that we want to know.
Yeah. So I'll, as I said, I am an NLP enthusiast. So I'll walk you through one of my notebooks on a very beginner-friendly dataset called Natural Language Processing with Disaster Tweet. So to give a primer about this data set is basically for tweets. So this is a collection of tweet text and tweet hashtags and all those things. And this lets you understand that whether a tweet is about a disaster or not. So this is a classification data set. So basically, for solving this problem, I tried to use not like deep learning, but I tried to go by basic machine learning and feature engineering methods. So as I said, basically for understanding the notebook and all, I have created this good introduction, and I have written a small description of each of the sections, like what is the section and what all we have done there. So let's go to the first section. So in basic data exploration, so when you want to do a data exploration thing in text data, what you have to do is basically you can check the data row by row, and after reading it, you can sort of clean it and keep on checking. And that will help you do. So here, just like this, we have used regex to clean it. So on checking the data, you can see that the keywords have a issue, like this the gap comes as percentage 20.
Right.
So I have created this small function to clean it like that. And then other thing is that so there will be every time you use text data, there will be signs like hashtag, comma, apostrophe, all those things which are not used in basically with whatever process you work on, like TF-IDF, or if you pass it to a Keras model or anything, then you will have to get rid of these signs. So for this, I created this regex form. And in the disaster tweet, there is another good notebook from which I have taken this other part, where you clean the text out of all the punctuations as well as misspelled dictionary.
Okay, can you go to the top section once, this place? Just below that. The characters that you removed. A little more. Yeah, here. So guys, so these puncts are basically certain characters. And as you can note, there are some special characters that are there in the between there, like the square is there, there is some dollar symbol, and all of these things. Right now, typically when you type this, you will not get this easily, but these are typically some emojis or something like that come up, and when it converts text, it looks like this, right? And so it's always good practice to take from others, like how Shambhu has taken to utilize and then clean it, so that you're thoroughly cleaning it up without leaving any traces of punctuations. Is that right, Shambhu?
Yeah, that's right.
Yep.
So this is another thing you need to do in Kaggle. Basically, if you're creating a notebook where people have already done a lot of work, then you can actually go through others' notebook before creating something on your own, because that will give you resources like this, which you can, use without reproducing it. So here is this misspelled dictionary, which is basically, it removes all the contractions, in grammatical contractions, like aren't to, are not, and all those things. There is another library called contractions, that also we could have used, but I used the dictionary.
Yeah, at beginning when you are using, you're better off starting this than using multiple packages. But ultimately in production, you'll have to use the packages.
Absolutely. So we created the punctuations, and then we wrote this number of functions, like clean text, where we are creating and we are cleaning the punctuations, we are cleaning of numbers. So this could have been done also using regex. Not like this, but the format we used beforehand, like, so I'll just show once which format I'm talking about. So instead of writing 0 to 9 here, If you do not write 0 to 9, then it will remove your numbers also.
Got it.
So that also you could have done. So other than that, here, so another important thing is that all of this removing and all we are doing in regex, this we are creating a space on removing these things. So what you need to do finally before going is you need to gap that all those spaces into one small space. Like you may have multiple 6-7 spaces, and that messes up with the calculations of PFIDF and all those things. So you'll have to remove all this space.
Okay.
So this line does that.
Got it.
So finally, we applied all the cleaning in one big function and we run it. Yeah.
So now everything is cleaned. So basically, you have certain amount of text, and then now your special characters, your punctuations, your couldn'ts, like those words, any spaces are reduced to single spaces, and now we have only pure clean text.
Yes, yes. So another thing is that always you can read the fields and come up with your own features. Like here, when I read about the read the location and text features, I saw that basically you can create some other features. So that's what the feature generation part is about. Basically,
so in this particular example, we have the tweet ID or something, the tweet itself, and then the classification, right, for training. Can we look at the sample data? Can you open another tab and just open the data set there?
Yeah, once.
Yeah, just the data, yes. And click on train, please.
So there are these fields. The keyword is there, the location is there, and the text is there.
Correct.
Keyword and location is relatively much more empty, but there are some locations will be there.
So have you used keyword and locations by any chance?
Yeah, I have used them. So once you go through locations, there will be like some impossible or spammy locations. Like you can see worldwide. This is not a location. They are like, so there are a number of locations which you can check and check on reading the data set, basically, which I went through and wrote, like basically place, room, home, somewhere, door, all these things. So this is basically spam locations. So I went through this, and I created a list of these spam locations and created a feature out of it, that the location spamming. So because we are trying to detect whether it's about a real disaster or it's not. So if the location is spammy, so this is like an intuitive thing that if the location is spammy, probably that is not a disaster. Someone is missing.
Correct. Okay.
So we created this feature. And then again, another thing was that in the location, sometimes people will write latitudes and longitudes.
Okay.
So that is a very specific thing. Because in some disaster like earthquake and all, there will be specific latitude and longitude values. So on cleaning also, we kept the digits. So now I am trying to calculate whether there is any digit in.
Got it. So can we now move back to that part? So we now have locations which requires a little bit of cleaning, and also the keyword. Basically, okay, so where were we? Here, right?
Yeah.
So next, what did we do?
Yeah, so after creating these features, we also created the, so whenever you have text data,
so we are in the features part, right? Can you move up?
I created some custom features.
Yes. So what, yeah, feature generation. Yeah. So what were those custom features?
So the custom features are basically these things: spammy location checking, and then checking whether there is a digit in the location.
Got it. Okay, fair enough. Next.
Yeah. So next, what we have done is basically we have created the normal features which come up in any NLP exercise. So the normally what you will try to do is, if you have a classification problem in text, then you will create top words occurring in each classes. So for doing that, we have used the NLTK library.
Okay.
So, yeah. So we first created the corpus. Then, using NLTK, what we have done is, created top 50 disaster words and top 50 non-disaster words.
Okay.
So here I didn't print it because it will be a long list. So, but someone can like unhash it and run.
Okay.
So I kept these things. And then basically what you can check is, using these top 50 words, you can understand that there is a significant difference or not. So in the disaster and non-disaster words, there is significant difference, but to get the exclusive words, so basically there will be some overlap, right, in the top 50 disaster and non-disaster words. So what we did is we set difference. So this is what I have created for final feature case, and is I have taken 200 words, and then I have created a set difference.
Okay.
Yeah. To get the exclusive words which occur in classes. And then for each of these words, I have created a is present feature, which is basically counting that word, if it is there or not. So this is how you can use the top words. Other than that, another
so
famous
each feature. Top word becomes one feature.
Other than that, what we have done is we have created TF-IDF. So TF-IDF is like bread and butter in NLP.
Yes. So basically, instead of using one word as a, like we use top 200 words, each individual word as a feature, but here we are, instead of using words, we are using two word combination, three word combination, or a four word combination. Is that right?
So in the n-gram range, you can fix how much length of an n-gram you want to take. So I have taken 1, 2, 3, basically, meaning that I have taken up to 3 grams. So trigrams, whatever you want to download. And then there is this, basically, you have to train it on the corpus, and then you have to create the features, fit transform you have used.
Got it.
So this is like all the code for doing that and like creating the features and merging.
So now we have a data set which had 5 columns. Now there will be roughly, maybe how many columns will be there here now after creating these many features?
There'll be around, I think, say 5,000 and 1,500. So around 9,000 or 8,000 features.
Yeah. So basically, team, you know, there is a lot of, so basically, guys, there is a lot of features. That is, you have your top 200 words, you have your TF-IDF word, you know, bigrams, trigrams, and all of that. And all of them are now added to the data set alongside each of the tweets that are there, right? So we have you know, we started with 5 variables, but we now have around 9,000 variables for helping us classify whether that is a tweet for a disaster or not, right? Okay.
So another thing, so what I did after this initially, in earlier versions, I ran it with this, but still, another thing about Kaggle is that in as a lot of people are participating in competitions, you can see that there are some levels of scores. Like with all these features, I was getting around like 78% accuracy. So I thought that what all, what other things we can do. Other than like, so in this notebook, I didn't want to go into details of modeling and fine tuning. I just wanted to create good features, which will increase the accuracy on their own. So then the idea occurred to me to include the vector embeddings.
And what is vector embedding?
So vector embedding is basically, so this is another concept in NLP. So vector embedding is basically when you imagine the words in a higher dimensional space, where the words which are having near meaning, similar meaning, will be together, and words which have different types of meaning, they will be far apart from each other. So generally, like there are multiple vector embeddings, like what to heck, glow, and others. So here we have used, so the spacey's vector embedding. So spacey has its own vector embeddings created from the word to vec model, but they have trained it on their own 2 billion words.
So it is basically readily available for us to use rather than we doing that whole process again. Okay.
So this like, so vector embedding, we generally use the pre-trained ones. So again, so pre-trained is another concept in NLP because you must have heard about all this GPT-3 and GPT-2.
Yes.
People are using so much resources to train. We do not have.
We have one Kaggle resource 30 hours a week and Google Colab.
So yeah, so basically most of the times we will be using pre-trained models for either say different NLP tasks. So here also I have used spacey's vector embedding. So this is how I have basically created the spacey vectors and created the vectors using this create vec and then concatenated it. So this is what it will do is it will add 300 more features. Actually, in some way, it means it has a semantic meaning of the word, the tweet. So the whole idea, like the semantic understanding of the tweet is also now included as our features. Once we add the vectors.
So we have now, let's say 9,000 plus the vector embeddings, 300 more features. Okay.
So after doing this, we have started modeling.
And you do your typical split, train test split, and then you build on the model. And which so in the NLP, which algorithm typically works, like the base algorithm we should begin with.
Yeah. So the base algorithm you want to begin with is basically naive bias. Okay. So naive bias have a number of types, like multinomial naive bias is there. Then there is vanilla naive bias. So I have added the naive bias here, but because, so there is a issue with naive bias is that as naive bias considers probability of words, you cannot use negative features with that. And using the vector embeddings, I got some negative values. So I didn't use the naive bias here. But what we could have done, so I have mentioned it. So we could have done that. We could have scaled the features to be absolute. And then we could have used naive bias.
Okay.
So yeah, just like you can see, I have I used multinomial naive bias in earlier versions. And you have to tune it for the alpha. That's a parameter in the model which you have to tune it for.
Got it.
So there is, I think there is another person's notebook called Sai Sriram or someone. He has a good notebook on how to tune it using different. So this get AVC is taken from that.
Okay.
Yeah. So basically tuning it using AUC loss.
So you have used, so ultimately to keep it simple, you have used random forest.
Yes, random forest and HDBoost.
Okay.
Then,
Okay.
so here I use the random forest, here I have used the XGBoost. So it's I sort of overtrained it a lot, as you can see.
Yes.
I'm feeling a bit lazy on that. Yeah. So you have to. So XGBoost hyperparameter tuning is again a
Big.
new thing for me.
Yes, yeah, it's not as simple as doing random forest hypertuning or any other before the decision trees or something like that.
I mean, you can code the all algorithms a similar code, but I have always seen that XGBoost performs better than random forest in most of the cases.
Right.
Like, yeah, there are cases where XGBoost doesn't perform good, but
Most cases, typical cases, but the parameters you have to get it right, like hyperparameters, right? That you have to experiment a lot, right?
yeah, so this brings us to the end of the notebook. Here I have created the sample submission.
So with this notebook, you are able to, can we see the ranking, how much you are able to rank on that?
Yeah, I ranked on the 40%. Like, yeah, I ranked on 471 with the 80% score. Yeah, so.
So how much more realistically we can do? Like, what are the next steps others can follow to improve this?
Yeah, so other things which we can could have done is that reading the text more and coming up with some more genuine features which one can do reading the text. So the text has different, so there are some really good other notebooks like which has explored a lot of features generation than me. They have gone through the text, they have create, so you can create more visualizations to understand what are the different types of text coming up and what are the different types of words coming up, all those things. Other than that, you could have used Saply or Lime or something to get an explanation and feature importance for each of the variables, because sometimes dropping the less important features will increase your accuracy, so that we could have done. Then this last thing, which is like obvious, is we could have done LSTM and other modeling. So that is a very different thing. So for that, I guess there are some good notebooks. I'd like to mention someone said 2% of the. Okay. One second. Yeah. So I like to mention this notebook, Fine Tuning BERT 88% accuracy. This is a very good notebook for anyone who wants to start with BERT modeling and all. So this guy, Vishal Siram, has done a really great job. He's a Kaggle notebook master. He has done a really great job in explaining how to use BERT for modeling. So yeah, so people can check the highly upvoted notebooks, because most of the time highly upvoted notebooks does a really great job in exploring the data and modeling it with different things. Yeah.
Absolutely. So good. Thanks. Thanks for walking us through this notebook, Shambhu, and hope our audience got to know a lot from this particular thing. And also, Shambhu is open for any coaching calls or tips or tricks that you want to learn from him. So do reach out to him. He's a NLP enthusiast, so anything regarding an NLP world, you can reach out to him, and he'll be kind enough to walk you through or help you there. And so you can they reach out to you through LinkedIn, Shambhu?
Yeah, I will prefer LinkedIn chats. Yeah.
Yeah, so I'll provide Shambhu's link in the LinkedIn link in the comment section so you can reach out to him. And how did you find this session, Shambhu?
Yeah, it was really great discussing my favorite things with you. Thanks for having me here. And yeah, it's always great to discuss data science with a person like you.
Absolutely. And hopefully let's do another round of things when you're doing or discovering things, maybe on BERT or anything else that you're working on new. So that way, let's see the discussions continue.